Hello everyone, it's Spawnpoint and welcome back to another video. And today we're unboxing the 2021 16-inch M1 MacBook Pro, which I am really excited to show you. I've been using my 15-inch MacBook Pro since 2018, so this feels like it's going to be a huge upgrade for me. We'll get this unboxed and then we'll take a look around to see what's new, what's changed, and what my first impressions are, including things like the notch, ports, and the overall design. I will be doing more MacBook Pro videos over the coming weeks, including the 14-inch model and comparing it to my old MacBook. I'll also do a fuller review of this after I've used it properly for a couple of weeks. So if you want to see more content from me, please hit that like button and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Right, let's get this opened up and see what's inside. And here's a little bit of ASMR for you. So I've gone for the space grey colour, and this looks absolutely awesome. I love that flat design and the rounded edges, but damn, this is thick. This is really thick. Under the Mac, there's the charging cable, which is a MagSafe to USB-C. Here's the usual paperwork, which we'll never read, but we do get some nice black stickers this time. Does anyone use these stickers, or do they just live inside the box until you sell it? I don't think I've ever used these. Now, as this is the 16-inch model, it comes with a 140-watt charger, whereas the 14-inch comes with a 67-watt or 96-watt charger, depending on the spec you go for. And that's all we get inside the box. Before we turn it on, I just want to talk about the exterior and the overall design. First impressions, this is nice. It feels solid, sturdy, and it kind of feels premium as well. So it's got an aluminium case, and I like the shape and the design of the edges. They look more rounded and flatter than I expected. Now, before buying it, I wasn't actually sure on this style, but having seen it now, it is really nice. But as I've said already, this is thick. It's noticeably thicker than the previous model that I've been using. So it's about 16.7mm thick, and it feels quite bulky when you're holding it. Luckily for me, mine doesn't really leave the house that often, so the bulk and the weight isn't a huge issue for me. I love the branding on the bottom, so it has the MacBook Pro text etched into the case itself. Obviously, this isn't something that you're going to see too often, but it's a nice touch. Although saying that, I can imagine this actually picking up dust and dirt pretty easily if you're not careful. These circular rubber feet, they look pretty heavy duty looking, but it lifts the Mac slightly off the table and they'll obviously keep it from moving around. The lid has the usual Apple logo on it, something that we've seen for years, and again is slightly reflective. And here are the dimensions of the 16-inch model that I have here. And I've also added the 14-inch measurements too, just to give you an idea of the difference. But lifting it up, it does feel heavy. Now, bearing in mind, this is the 16-inch, so it's going to be heavier than the 14. But also, depending on if you go for the M1 Pro or the M1 Max chip, the weight is slightly different again. Looking at the ports, which is one of the biggest additions this year. Now, I know we've had ports before, but it's good to have them back. That means no more dongles if you're using an SD card or an HDMI cable. On the left, we've got the MagSafe for charging, we've got two Thunderbolt 4 USB-C ports, and a headphone jack. Then on the right, there's the SD card slot, another Thunderbolt 4 USB-C port, and the HDMI out. For me, the port that I'm actually most excited about is actually the MagSafe port itself. The charger just snaps on and off, and you know what? It sounds really satisfying each time that it snaps on. I've never had an issue using the USB-C ports for charging my old MacBook, but I know it's safer, more convenient, and faster to charge with this instead. But if you want to or you need to, you can still use the USB-C ports for charging. As for the HDMI port, well, this is an HDMI 2.0, not 2.1, something that you might assume that it would come with. But the biggest addition which has been added back on is the SD card slot. So for anyone using a camera to record content or take photos, this is going to be the easiest way to transfer your data. It's also great to see that we've got the headphone jack still here, a feature that most people might not actually use, but when it comes to editing videos or music, this is the best way to do it. Okay, let's get this opened up. This is the moment that we've all been waiting for. Just how bad or noticeable is the notch? So we've got the same little cutout on the lid to lift it up, and as it's pretty weighty, you can actually do this one-handed and it won't move or lift the base. Now, just ignoring the notch completely for a second, this screen looks incredible. It's bright, it's vibrant, and the colours look really good. This is a liquid Retina XDR screen, so it has got 10,000 mini LEDs. Plus, as it's got the new ProMotion 120Hz display, just moving around feels and looks really fast and snappy. But there's no denying that the first thing you notice as soon as you turn it on is the notch. I didn't think it would actually be this noticeable, but it does stand out, especially if you've got the status bar or the wallpaper set to a light theme. I've already seen that there are third-party apps out there which can turn the status bar black, which will hide the notch, but that's just kind of like a weird workaround. This will definitely take some getting used to, but to be honest, I did the same with the iPhone, and after a few weeks of using it with a notch, you kind of forget about it anyway. Now, without testing, I am wondering whether all apps and windows will be optimized for this notch, and will menus always take this into account, or will data be hidden behind it? One thing that I did test out straight away was, where does the cursor go? Does it go behind the notch, or does it go around it? And here's the answer, so it does move behind the notch. Now, the overall frame itself, the actual bezel around the screen, is a lot thinner than before, so visually it does look really, really nice. Now, one thing I did notice is the status bar across the top. It looks a little bit taller than what we've seen before, but I am assuming that is to take the notch into account. Looking around the screen, the edges are slightly rounded at the top, but they're squared off at the bottom here. Overall, though, this screen does look really nice, and it's definitely a step up from what we've had before. I am really looking forward to editing photos and videos on this over the coming weeks. The keypad on this looks great. Now, I love the black design of the keys and the backing. It definitely has an old school MacBook vibe to it. Now, I know a lot didn't like the touch bar on the previous models, but it's something that I did get used to. Well, that touch bar has obviously now been replaced with physical keys again. Then at the top right, we've got the fingerprint reader, which you can use for Touch ID and making purchases. I'm really pleased with it we've still got this, although Face ID would have been a great addition to have had. But typing on the keyboard actually feels really nice. Now, having used the butterfly keys for the last 3 years, this does feel totally different to me, but it definitely feels like a step up. And then there's the trackpad, which is awesome, as you would expect. It's so responsive and so accurate. So you might be interested in knowing what spec that I've gone for. Well, I've got the 16-inch M1 Max model with 32GB of RAM and a 1TB SSD. This is more than I need right now, and it's borderline overkill for editing my weekly videos. I did originally order the base spec M1 Pro with the 16GB of RAM, but as I plan on keeping this for around 3 years again, I wanted something that I think will be future-proof. But there are loads of spec configurations to choose from, including the M1 Pro and the M1 Max chip, 16GB, 32GB and 64GB memory, plus anywhere from 512GB SSD up to 8TB. First impressions though, I like this a lot, and from what I've seen and used so far, this is going to be a huge step up for me. The design is nice, it's great to see the ports back, and the keyboard is nice to type on. The screen looks great too, but the notch will take some getting used to. But there's loads more that I want to cover, including the 6-speaker setup, incredible battery life, chip performance, and the fan noise. But I will leave that for a full review once I've got hands on. What I'm going to do is I'm going to transfer all my files over to the new MacBook this week, and I'll properly use it for a couple of weeks. I'll do some edits and exports for some upcoming videos, then I can give you my honest review from a real user point of view. Now, this new MacBook was bought by me, and it will be my one and only MacBook that I'll be using. So with that in mind, if you've got any questions at all, please drop those in the comments, and I will test it or I will answer it for you. Well, you've made it to the end of today's video, so thank you for watching. And if you drop an M1 MacBook Pro in the comments, I will give you a thumbs up, as I know you're still here. And also, here's another couple of videos that you might be interested in watching next. Don't forget to hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and turn notifications on so you don't miss my next upload. You can also follow me over on Instagram and Twitter. Until next time.